Hello everyone, and welcome to this recorded session of our meetup that we had here on the premises. The meetup was about creating robust AI and machine learning solutions in an industrial environment. And in this session, I hope to give you a summary of the key elements that are required to set up a robust machine learning process. So the real question is, how can we apply this machine learning in a production facility? And specifically then, in our case, at Prodrive Technologies. So I will give you an example use case of our visual inspection setup, and the goal is to use machine learning to automate this process in our factory. But let's first look at some products from Prodrive. So Prodrive manufactures many different electronics, and I just give an example here of a few. So we have an automotive wall box and an automotive air quality sensor, both automotive products with high stringent requirements. And we also make rack servers, completely different for high-end computing, but also linear actuators and I/O modules for high IP rated setups. So a broad setup of different components. And we design them in-house, but we also manufacture them in-house. And within our company, we have a program called Industrial Automation. And within this program, we develop automated manufacturing solutions. Such as you can see here in the slide, we have an automated solution line, which basically manufactures the sensor you saw in the previous slide, completely autonomous. So 24/7 production without any human interaction. And we tend to call this principle also the factory of the future, or in our case, even the lights out factory, because you can turn the lights off, there are no people required anymore. And then you have such an automated line set up, but it also needs to be fed with components. And we have created our AGV, automated guided vehicle, which can deliver these components to the solution to make sure that it can run nonstop. Basically, it does jobs between an automated warehouse and this automated manufacturing line. Okay, great. So we have some idea of what Prodrive does, but how does this actually relate to machine learning and specifically at visual inspection? So within visual inspection, we can distinguish a few different types of inspection. So the first one would be presence. That's actually the most simple one, most easy to understand. So as an example here, you see some connectors with cables. If the cable is not present, then that's a presence defect. The same holds for this image with the screw. So on the right side, you see an image that does not have a screw present, which is a fail. Going a little bit deeper, we go into alignment, so to detect misalignment, basically. And in the example here, you can see that the wires are actually present, but they're not fully pressed in this connector, so they're misaligned, basically. So it's similar to the first case, although a little bit harder because you have to find the alignment. And finally, we have damage, which is the most broadest category of defects, basically, that we have to detect. In this case, I show as an example a sealant line, so a glue line with a piece cut out, but it could also be damaged text because there's a scratch on your housing. And these three types we consider as the main types. Okay, then you would say, can I automate this somehow? You can make a dedicated algorithm, but solving it with machine learning can solve many more problems because you can do it data-driven and you don't need, in principle, software engineers to write a dedicated algorithm. So how would you get started by just training a model? In that case, let's start with the data. So we have a data set of these images. These are the same images I showed you before, so of these cables, and we have images of correct products and incorrect products. However, if you want to use machine learning, you have to apply labels as well. So somebody has to label this data, which might be on some network drive somewhere stored, probably not structured, so you have to do some structuring there. And we apply labels. So you can see some images are pass, some of them are fail. Well, then we are probably ready now to actually start training a machine learning model. And we pass this data to one of our data scientists or machine learning engineers. And they can get started with the Jupyter notebook and then use this data as an input to train a model, for instance, using a Keras model architecture with some transfer learning from existing data sets. Maybe they have a state-of-the-art PyTorch model. Anyhow, they end up training a really good model. They save it into a file, and basically their job is done. They say, yeah, this model performs perfect, and you can use it in production. Okay, but then we need to integrate this somehow in the camera setup to automate this inspection. So what will then happen is that this model is passed over to the software engineer, who then starts using this model, this file, but actually he has no idea how to use it. Should he like normalize the image? Does he need to apply some transformation? And also at the output of the model, what comes out? Is it a label or is it some score? And how does it then relate to the outcome? Is it pass or fail? That's all not known to the software engineer. So you should go back and forth with the data scientist to really see how it works. Maybe finally he can integrate it in the setup and people in our production facilities can actually use it. So they can start this setup, take a picture, does the inspection, and it works. And after some time and beginning, oh, it looks really good, it makes the correct predictions. But at some time, it starts to deteriorate, it starts to make incorrect predictions. Maybe at some point they would like to retrain the model, but they have no idea. The data scientist maybe no longer works at your company, people cannot retrain it anymore. And they also have no idea on why the performance is deteriorating, and at some point what will happen, unfortunately, is that the model is scrapped, the automated setup is decommissioned, and they're just doing it manually again. So then the question is, how can we avoid this, obviously? And maybe before I'm going to answer that question, let's look at some of the tool sets that you could get started to. I mentioned already Keras and PyTorch, which are the two deep learning frameworks that we use to build our machine learning models, specifically deep learning models. We also use MLflow to track our models and experiments in production. And we use Kubernetes, and that's the logo from Kubernetes, to deploy them in a scalable way. But this is just a small piece of the whole puzzle. We actually use a lot more libraries. And this is actually the whole story of almost all the libraries that are available in tooling to be able to do machine learning in production, from platforms to label your data, to train your models, to deploy them, to monitor them, all those kind of things. That's all in this landscape, but it's really daunting, basically. And especially if you're new as a company and you want to employ these, you have the question, where can I start, right? And that's the main thing to answer here. Okay. Let's just really start at the beginning, make it really simple. Let's start with the data. In my opinion, that's the first step to start looking at if you want to apply machine learning in your company. And within data, there are a few several elements that you can take into account if you want to be able to control your data in a manageable way. And the first thing is actually, what do you want to do with this data? What is actually your goal of your machine learning model? And as you can see here, in our case, with visual inspection, this is what is actually the inspection task you want to do. Can you define that and write that down in a structured way and store that in a database, for instance? So you can see this image here. You have the rectangles that indicate what you want to inspect, and also if it's a presence type of inspection or an alignment type of inspection. All that data you need to know beforehand, so you're actually solving the correct problem. And that really is the first phase of structuring this, basically, and standardizing. Another one is that as Prodrive is not only a company that produces and designs electronics, we have electronics developers, mechanical developers, and software developers. We can also design our own inspection setups. And in that sense, you can see this example setup here, which is a capturing setup that can take pictures of over 80% of our product portfolio, and from five sides. So in that sense, we can automate the capturing and standardize it so that the images that we capture are similar every time and not differing, which makes it hard for a model to be trained on. And the final part of this is that I mentioned that you often have a data set, but you don't have labels. How do you apply labels to this data set in a structured way? For that purpose, we have created this annotation tool. It's a simple tool that, for instance, people in production, but also developers, so people in production, I mean people in the factory, but us as developers, we can they can both label the data. For instance, this is an example where you can see the golden sample is the correct product, the current sample is a product without the nut, and it is marked as a presence defect because this nut is indeed missing. And that's a structured way of labeling your data. Okay, so we've looked into standardizing and versioning our data, basically. But now the question is, how do we do the training then? Can we do that in a structured way so that not only the data scientist can do it? And when somebody has done it, how did they do it? That's basically the question we want to answer there. So to start off with one thing first is often machine learning models tend to focus on the data they've been trained on. That's basically their goal. And if that data contains a certain bias, for instance, there are a lot of bright images or images of a certain product that had a certain color, then it's really good with those. But if your environment changes, for instance, you're in a darker environment or your product is slightly different, then the performance of your model will also be worse. With data augmentation, you actually try to focus the model on the task at hand, which in this case is the detection if this screw is present or not. And what you do with augmentation is that you, for instance, remove the color, change the color, zoom it in, zoom out, rotate, all kind of transformations to make sure that the model is trained on recognizing the screw and not recognizing the color or the brightness of an image. In training a model, people often do it maybe just as an experiment locally on their laptop or maybe in some cloud service, but that's often not structured. And the problem is it might also take a long time if you do it locally, especially if you have a big complex model. We've used Ray, which is an open source library in Python, and it also has a plugin for machine learning models to be able to train them on multiple machines at the same time in a distributed way. And in that sense, if you set it up like that, you can also track your experiments and run them quickly and multiple at the same time in parallel. That set is nice, but then the problem is that you have all these experiments, we have no idea what the performance was of each experiment in a structured way. And I mentioned that we use MLflow. Well, this is the one of the key things that we use it for, is the tracking of our experiments. So you've run multiple machine learning models, training runs for them, and you want to compare their performance, basically, and see how well they do compared to each other. In that sense, you can select the best model. And the thing here is you can also see which models, which parameters gave the best performance and which data was used that gave the best performance. Okay, great. So we have our data versioned, our models are versioned. Now we're ready to deploy them in production. So where do we get started with that, right? We have this model file then somewhere, but how do we actually can use it in our inspection setup? A really good place to start, at least, is that when you have your best model selected from your experiment, you have to version it. And that, what that actually means, it's also a process called model registration, is that you apply this version number, let's say version 1, but you also know where did it come from. Is it from which data set was used, which model architecture was used? That is all relevant if you later want to improve on it and see which model are you actually using in production. But let's look at an example flow of how this would work out. So we have trained this model, we have our camera setup, and our camera setup takes a picture, and then somehow we have to get this to the model. I use here a model service that we run on our Kubernetes cluster. So that's as a web service, basically. The image is received by this model service, and the results are sent back, just as a simple dumbed down way of working. What's really important here is to also log your data to a centralized database, because we want to know how this model is performing in production. So maybe later, if something goes wrong, you want to know where it went wrong and on which products. If it then indeed goes wrong, you might want to retrain your model and then deploy this new model in production. However, you might not know for sure that this model is going to perform better than your current model in production. So you have done two versions, let's say version 1 and version 2. What you can do is something called shadow mode, and you can deploy it as a shadow model. And what that would mean is that you basically take this version 2 model, you put it in parallel with your production model, they receive the same input, and you can see how they would do in your logging database. But the shadow mode model does not report back. So it's just running in the background. And if at some point it is indeed better and outperforming your production model, well, great. You can promote your shadow model to the production model, and you can archive your production model, and you have a new improved model. Well, that would be a nice story, right? Data under control, model training under control, and we have our deployment all said and done. We're ready for production. Well, no, unfortunately, because what happens if the model starts performing bad? If it starts to drift over time, then you have no idea if this is happening, right? You have the logging database, but then you need to actively look into that. So the real important part here is to have this feedback loop from the deployment back to the data. So we need to have monitoring and feedback to make sure that your model keeps performing well over time. So let's look at an example view of that. So what you can see here is basically the output score of a model. You see some values close to zero, some values close to one. And in this case, zero means passing product, and one means there's a defect on that product. And the red line indicates the threshold of 0.5 to see whether it's a defect or a pass. If you look closely, however, you see that there's one outlier close to this threshold of 0.43, which means, is it actually certain about this prediction? Is it actually a pass or failing product? So what you need to do here is basically put a band around that threshold. And if there's a certain amount of predictions within this band, then you could say, hey, maybe we should check out if the model is actually performing well or not. Or if there, maybe it's actually making some misclassifications and we should improve on that. If that is the case, that it's actually mispredicting it, misclassifying it, then you want to provide feedback for retraining of this model. And I mentioned this labeling interface. Well, the same interface you could use again to apply these corrections, basically, to improve your model over time and allow for retraining. And in that sense, you have a nice guided process of evolving and improving your models over time. So I mentioned these four steps, and actually these four steps are part of a process called the MLOps process. A lot of companies know a different process actually called DevOps, which most of you might be familiar with. And that's a process of being able to robustly develop and release software in your company. So you see the dev and ops part. The dev part is really developing your software, writing new software, reviewing it with people, and the ops part is rolling it out in production, monitoring how your software does, performs in production, configuring it, all those kind of parts. That's well known to a lot of companies. And with MLOps, you actually just extend this with two extra loops, namely the data loop. So how do you version your data? How do you track it? How do you standardize it? How do you collect it? All those kind of steps are relevant for that part. And then you have the ML cycle, where you're actually training your models and maybe even comparing them, optimizing them, all those kind of steps you also have to look into. And if you look closely in this figure, you see indeed there's production on the left side and on the right side. So this is also one big loop that in production, you should be able to capture new data and start this cycle again from the beginning. A good point to continue maybe, if you're interested in the part research in this idea, this MLOps process, is the ML-Ops website, mlops.org, and it has way, way more information that I can convey to you in this presentation. So if you're interested, definitely check that website out. And that was more or less my story. So I hope to that I've shared some interesting knowledge with you, and I hope to see you at our next meetup. So please subscribe.